Yeah, so I will, sorry, I forgot your name. As you introduced me, I will try to link sort of like what's going on in mice and in human by focusing on also primates, but non-human primates. And in my talk, I will sort of like try to give an overview of the things we have been doing over the past couple of years by looking at correspondences between basically non-human primates, monkeys, and human subjects. So we are a species endowed with incredible cognitive capacities, right? Much more, or at least that's what we think, much more capacities, cognitive capacities than any other species. So for example, we can develop, think about things, make things, and actually, unlike any other species, like a tool like this basically, we can already anticipate what the outcome is from using tools. Most other species that are using tools basically learn it by trial and error, and they see that the tool has an effect to be used. So we are sort of like at a higher level. This is just one example. Of course, there are many other examples where we are we can be distinguished from most, if not all, other species on Earth. At least that's what we think. Are we different? Maybe we're not that different, right? So the focus of my talk will be what is it that drives the differences, but also the similarities between us and lower species. And of course, big question is, what is it that makes us different, but also what is it that makes us similar? Obviously, a big thing is the brain. Probably the answer to these questions resides within the brain, at least to a large extent. And already a very prominent difference is size of brains between different species. Yeah? Our brain is rather large relative to our body mass compared to, for example, this is human brain, compared to, for example, non-human macaque brains, as you see here. But it's definitely so that brain is not, or brain size is not everything that matters. There are also species, elephants and dolphins, which do have very large brains. So of course, not in case of the elephant, but in case of the dolphin, also relative to their body mass. Of course, these are also very intelligent creatures, species, but still, most of us think that we have a higher level of intelligence, have more advanced cognitive capacities than these other species. Whether that's true or not, I leave it in between. I don't make any statement there. The thing that I'm interested in is basically trying to understand what is similar and different between species, between primate species. Why? Because I think it's very important also to understand how we evolved, how our brains evolved, and even more important, if we understand similarities and differences between species, we can start to investigate particular functions in much more detail in species where we have access to the brain, where we have much less access in human brains. Yeah? So basically, if we know that area X in the human corresponds to area X in a monkey, we can start to do follow-up experiments in these monkeys with tools that have typically a much higher spatiotemporal resolution than the tools that you can apply in normal human subjects, for ethical reasons, of course. Yeah. To give an overview of my talk, we don't have too much time, so I can't expand to all the little details. So in my talk, I will mainly talk about or focus upon correspondences across species and giving a snapshot of things that we have done over the past couple of years. And I will very briefly say how we do it. And of course, interrupt me if you want to have more details, if you want to know about the details, how specifically you're doing. This is basically an hour worth of talking if I just want to talk about the methods. And then I will go over a number of experiments that we did over the past years where we also use different types of analysis methods. So we have been improving on the way on the ways where how we analyze basically our data in our comparative research. Yeah. So how do we do that? How would you do it, actually? How would you do it?
How would you sort of like try to figure out whether a particular part of your brain corresponds or not corresponds to a part of the brain of someone else? How would you do
me?
Yeah.
I would design tasks that could be performed by humans and, for example, by a mouse.
Yeah.
And then take a look, for example, in an MRI scanner,
yeah,
which areas are active,
yeah,
doing a specific task, and then,
yeah,
try to relate.
Yeah. I think broadly that's more or less what I do. The only thing is that I don't take a mouse. One reason for not taking a mouse is that it's already very difficult actually to train mice to perform active tasks in a scanner. It's much easier to train, for example, a monkey to do complex cognitive tasks, which sometimes mice even are not able to do. Which doesn't mean that mice can't do it, right? But it's much, 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 much harder, right? So we are training actually non-human primates, macaques, to perform very, very difficult cognitive tasks, where I think that the mice don't have the capacities actually to do very similar things. Yeah? We can learn everything basically in outside the scanner, and then have these kind of experiments being done inside the scanner. And that's exactly what we do. Sort of like we train animals to perform tasks. These can be simple tasks, just like simply looking at the screen and then presenting all kinds of visual stimuli, auditory stimuli, tactile stimuli, whatever you want. Or you can train them on very, very difficult tasks to do a cognitive operation. Very difficult attention tasks, memory tasks, motor tasks, and so forth and so forth. Yeah. So basically what we do is we train these animals and then we plug them into a scanner, and then everything else is very, very similar to what people are doing with humans. For example, what you heard this morning from Reiner. Yeah. And then we sort of like train them, for example, in this case to fixate, presenting stimuli. This is just an example of a written topic mapping experiment. I'm not sure that Reiner also showed that. We do the same thing. Monkeys are fixating, and then we show sort of like expanding annuli or rotating wedges to map out the written topic organization of visual cortex. And we collect fMRI data in a very similar way as what Reiner did. We plug them in the scanner, but there are a few tricks that we are using to improve the sensitivity. Yeah? Reiner improves the sensitivity by buying high field scanners. This is one way to do that. You can improve your fMRI sensitivity by going to higher field, which means that either you get like for the same voxel size higher sensitivity, or you can start measuring smaller voxels. Yeah? And that's why Reiner is able to see columnar structures in the human brain, laminar structures in the human brain. Without that, no way that you could do it. Reiner would have a very hard time measuring at this scale with sort of like lower, between brackets, field scanners, 3 Tesla scanners, for example. Correct, Reiner?
Correct.
Yeah. So, but we have some tricks. So Reiner is a rich guy, so he can buy these high field scanners.
Convincing, convincing.
Right. We only had access to relatively lower field scanners in the beginning when I started out, 1.5 and now 3 Tesla scanner. But of course, with animals you can do a little bit more than with humans. So we have tricks to improve the sensitivity. And we do that by injecting contrast agents, just ferromagnetic materials in the bloodstream, and that improves your sensitivity already by a factor of 3. On top of that, we recently developed tools, I think this is a movie, where we implant in individual monkeys phase array coils, more or less the same what Reiner is using, but specifically adapted to the anatomy of the monkeys, to the skull of the monkeys. On top of that, you can also sort of like create, and that's sort of like the advantage of using non-human primates, you can follow up your imaging, your fMRI imaging, with all kinds of invasive approaches to record single cell activity, for example, from brain regions, or to perturb the activity with microstimulation, with optogenetics, with chemical tools, whatever you want, basically, which is, of course, much, much, much more difficult, if not impossible, in humans, right? So this, basically, this sort of like technology, which obviously is very difficult to do, not to say again, impossible in humans, we increase the sensitivity. You know, this is... This doesn't work, apparently. Oh, yeah, here it is. This basically increases our sensitivity by almost a log unit, right? Which brings us sort of like a little bit in the range where Reiner is scanning with his high field scanner, with the low field scanner, yeah? So, and again, I don't have time to go into details. With this kind of technology, we are also able to measure mesoscopic scale structures in the non-human primate. We do see columnar-like structures, we do see laminar-like structures in these monkeys at lower field compared to Reiner. So this is sort of like a little trick or little tricks that we are doing to improve our sensitivity. Why is that needed? A big disadvantage of using non-human primates is accessibility to animals, right? So I assume that quite a few of you are doing functional imaging in humans. Usually whenever you do an experiment, you scan a lot of subjects, right? If you want to make inferences about the population, if you want to do random effect type of analyses, you typically scan 20, 30, if not more, subjects. For us, that's much more difficult. It's way too expensive. It's actually impossible, basically, to have access to these large number of animals, which means that we are scanning the same animal the same animals multiple times, much more than what is typically being done in human fMRI experiments. Yeah. So basically, this are tricks to improve our sensitivity, which you can sort of like spend in better sensitivity for relatively large voxels, or you can also decrease the voxel size. So, bottom line is, we have methodology to do this, to do very, very similar functional experiments in monkeys and in humans, and to look at whole brain activity. I think this was one of the first techniques which allowed us to do that. Yeah, to really compare activity, fMRI activity, whatever that means in neural terms, in monkeys and in humans. So basically, we started out by performing relatively simple experiments. For example, quite a few years ago, we presented very similar stimuli to humans and monkeys. These lines, so we trained monkeys to fixate and we trained humans to fixate to a spot. And monkeys are very, very good at that. So they're basically, if you train them well, they're almost like machines. They're locking and they are with operant conditioning techniques, we can train them to really fixate very well to fixation point. And as you can see here, when these connected dots are simply translating, you don't perceive a nice form. Whenever it starts rotating, you immediately start to get, or normally you should see the percept of a 3D structure. Yeah? Of course, with all kinds of controls. If you present that to humans and to monkeys, you get sort of like something like this. In a human, this is a flat map, and I'm pretty sure that you have seen these flat maps also in Reiner's talk of human subjects. And if you compare these 3D versus 2D conditions, you basically see whatever you might expect. Activity, this is the back of the brain, more front of the brain, medial, and more ventral. And you see activity evoked by these 3D stimuli versus the 2D stimuli in early visual cortex, but also in what is LO cortex. I don't go into the details, it can be partitioned in multiple parts, and also including parts of the human MTV5 complex. On top of that, you also see these activations, 3D structure from motion-driven activation in parietal cortex. Yep. Simple question is, how does this look like in a monkey? When you do that in a monkey, you see more or less the same thing. Many structures are reacting to these stimuli in a very similar way. Yeah? You see, again, early visual cortex, V4-ish, sort of like the posterior end of the ventral stream, also MT or areas of the MT complex in the monkey, sort of very similar to what you see here in the human. But what was very, very apparent is the lack of 3D structure for motion sensitivity in the parietal cortex. The lack, total lack, no. There was a little bit of sensitivity, if you go to very sensitive analytical approaches, you do see a little bit of it, but for sure, much less so compared to humans. Yeah. So which means the parietal cortex of humans might share quite a few properties between monkey and human, but there are also profound differences there, which might be reflected in the way we perceive the world and these monkeys perceive the world. They might have like different ways perceiving 3D structure for motion compared to us. This is just an illustration where we use very simple approaches, just general linear model, techniques to look at activity. And probably you heard that in the rest of the, or in the previous talks during this week. And you sort of like spatially compare what's coming out. Not very advanced, basically. You do still have quite a bit of spatial assumptions here. Yeah? This is another example from experiments actually done in collaboration with Maastricht here, where we did a very, very similar experiment where in Maastricht they scanned human subjects and we scanned monkey subjects, where we presented all the three tones to these subjects, monkeys and humans, natural auditory stimuli. And then the analysis was slightly more complicated, yeah, in an analysis stream that has been developed here in Maastricht. But at the end, it's sort of more or less the same thing. You compare activity patterns between the two species, and this is just one example where we look at the tonotopy, at the frequency representation in primary or in early auditory cortex in the two species. And again, we saw sort of like highly similar patterns, in this case for the tonotopic organization, between the two species. But you can do more, right? So this is just an example where you present stimuli in a passive manner to different species, and you look at activity pattern, and you analyze it more or less in a similar way in the two species, and then you compare. You compare patterns, basically. Yeah. This is task-based, but there is also quite a bit of information, actually, in the brain when these subjects are not doing anything. And we engaged at some point when this became sort of like fashionable, also to do to perform these kind of what is called resting state experiments. You simply collect data while subjects are in the scanner and are doing nothing. They're closing their eyes, they have their eyes opening, but they're not engaged in one or the other specific cognitive task. So basically, in these experiments, we ask subjects, again humans and monkeys, to stare to a fixation dot, and we acquire fMRI data. Yeah. Of course, as you all know, and I'm pretty sure you heard about that this week already, you can then get resting state networks, different networks which show correlated activity. Voxels that belong to the same network will have a higher correlation in their activity pattern than voxels belonging to another network. Yeah. And you can sort of like detect these different networks by different statistical or analytical methods, for example, performing a very simple ICA approach, independent component analysis approach, all the signals that you're measuring throughout the brain, throughout the cortex, and that sort of like breaks the cortex up in these different resting state networks. So you get them in a monkey, and you get them in a human. And then the key thing is like, how do you compare them? Not easy, of course, because as I showed you in the beginning of this talk, that the brains have different sizes. Yeah. So one way to deal with it. It's not the only way. I will come to other ways later on in my talk. One way to deal with it is to try to match basically a monkey brain to a human brain or vice versa. I know this is science fiction. Human brain is not like a blown up version of a smaller monkey brain, but there are some people who try to do that by using anatomical and functional landmarks. Landmarks from which we know that they are relatively well preserved in species. For example, primary sensory cortex, visual area 1, V1, A1, S1, and so forth, is relatively well preserved, and there are some other structures that are also relatively well preserved. And then you can do that trick. It's actually David Van Essen who did that. So you can sort of like morph a monkey brain into human space. And there is a lot of assumptions that you're making, and there are a lot of mistakes that you're making, for sure. Yeah. But then, at least you have your networks in the same space, and you can start comparing them using spatial cluster analysis techniques. Yeah. And you can start to relate them and see whether they do or they do not make sense. And if you do that experiment, you simply scan these subjects. They are not doing anything, basically. You get, as you very well know, a list of resting state networks, yeah? In the human and in the monkey. Yeah? Then it's a matter of comparing them. And you can do sort of like a spatial hierarchical clustering, where the only constraint is that whenever you have a cluster, you need to have at least one human and one monkey resting state network in that pool. Yeah, can be more, it can be one. Yeah. And when you do that, you basically, and this is empirical data, because you could also get very weird results if you force an algorithm to cluster things which have nothing to do with each other, you will get a result.
Right.
So you can end up having very weird data, but just the empirical data showed us that this does work. For example, if you look at the foveal visual, near foveal visual network, peripheral visual network in monkey, you get sort of like reasonably similar correspondence with that spatial linking algorithm in the human foveal and more peripheral early visual network. Somatomotor networks usually breaks up in two parts in a monkey, and you more or less see the same thing in the human. Yeah? So there are known networks where you find relatively, with good confidence, a relatively good match in the other species. Yeah? So just by simply looking at resting state activity. Still, I think this is a very gross way of looking at correspondences between different species. So this is just an overview of networks that we sort of like identified to be relatively similar in the two species. However, we also found evidence for networks in the humans which did not have a correspondent in the monkey. I don't have time to go into details. We based this not only on resting state data, but also on activity data, where the subjects were actively engaged in a sensory task. And these are these networks, are sort of like two frontal parietal networks in the human and a singular insular network in the human, where we find very, very little evidence for something similar in the monkey, which makes sense, right? Our brain is different from the monkey, so for sure there are going to be areas which either have expanded dramatically in the human compared to the monkey, which basically gives space to additional new functions, cognitive functions, sensory functions, motor functions, and so forth, which do not exist in these other species, or maybe, and we don't know, it can also be the case that new areas evolved in the human, which are not at all existent in the monkey. Yeah. So this is sort of like an indication, just by functional data, that these are regions in the human brain that are very, very different in functional terms from the monkey brain. And actually, when you compare the location of these sort of like human unique resting nature networks with parts of the brain that have expanded more than average. Actually, this work from David Vanessa, you see a surprise, it's completely different experiments basically, you see a surprisingly good match between this resting state, these functional data, and these data from Van Essen, where he claims that the cortex expanded much more than average. Yeah, again, giving evidence or corroborating the hypothesis that these are regions where maybe human-specific functions are being processed. So this is sort of like based upon resting state data. This was sort of like using very, very simple analytical techniques where you have like very strict spatial assumptions, sort of like an area roughly located there, activated, roughly located there, activated in the other species, okay, they are matched. Maybe we shouldn't do that, right? Maybe we should not have spatial assumptions about where corresponding regions might be located in another species, in a non-human primate or even non-primate species. To deal with that, we developed a new method where we correlated actually the activity between regions in one brain, in one species, and the other species. fMRI at the end of the day yields, or by doing an fMRI experiment, you get sort of like a temporal signal. Yeah. Low temporal resolution, but you get like a temporal signal. So these signals can be correlated. Yeah. Of course, within humans, people are doing that all the time. But you can do that also across species. And that's exactly what we are doing in these kind of experiments. So basically, and I will give you examples from two experiments. Yeah. In the first experiment, we aimed to activate the cortex as much as possible, both in humans and in monkeys, and we basically...
I think this is a movie.
And you probably all know this movie, The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. So we asked subjects to not to fixate, to freely watch this movie, also together with the sound. Yeah, and actually the dots that you're seeing are gaze points of individual monkeys whenever they are looking at this movie. We did the same with the humans, and sort of like they are also looking at different parts of the movie. Importantly is that sensory stimulation was identical in the two species, so we showed exactly the same fragments to humans of that movie and to monkeys together with the auditory input. Yep. And then we collected fMRI data. Same thing in humans and in monkeys. The idea is that with this natural, between brackets, stimuli, you activate a large portion of the cortex. Yeah. You activate a big deal of visual cortex, but also of auditory cortex. So we wanted, so this was our purpose, we wanted to drive with these stimuli large portions of the cortex. And then try to figure out which of these portions are similar or not similar. And then you can sort of like starting to play games with this data, games that have been played before in human fMRI experiments, for example, by Uri Hassan's group already quite a few years ago. So you basically start to collect these time signals from individual voxels, corresponding to watching or listening to the movie in monkeys, right? In different monkeys. And then you can sort of like ask, okay, which voxels in one subject, which voxels correlate with the voxels in the other subject? Yeah. To look at intra-species correlations. Yeah. And you can do the same thing in humans. You have a human subject, you have another human subject, and you can look at intra-species correlations, yeah, sort of like synchronicity between the brains of different subjects, pioneered by Uri Hassan, if I'm not mistaken, pioneered by Uri Hassan. A lot of people have been doing it afterwards.
But of course, the more interesting approach is that you're sort of like trying to match up these temporal signals in one species with the other species. One way to do it is again using the same trick as I just explained, by blowing, or sort of like by transforming the monkey brain and bringing it into human space. So you basically do a deformation of the brain and you get sort of like a human-like monkey brain in the same space. And then you have like the human data, so you have like your monkey data in human space, and you have your monkey data, and then you can look at the corresponding locations in the two brains. One is a fake brain, one is a real brain, and see how well they are correlated. If you do that, if you look at the intraspecies correlations, you see that with these auditory visual stimulation, very rich stimulation, you get sort of like in the monkey, good synchronization in visual cortex. This is the back of the brain, the front of the brain, frontal cortex, this is infratemporal cortex, and you see large synchronization across base portions of visual cortex and also here frontal cortex. Surprisingly, not too much actually in auditory cortex. We are actually now running a completely different experiment with tactile auditory and visual stimuli where we get like very good auditory stimulation as well. This is what you do with the human. You get more or less the same kind of intraspecies correlations as published, as what Uri Hasselman basically published. When you do it across species, it becomes much smaller. You see visual cortex, again MT, the MT complex, and a tiny little bit in frontal cortex. Actually, from other experiments, sensory experiments, we have already seen that frontal cortex reacts very differently in human and monkey just by passive stimulation. Usually, when you give passive stimuli, visual stimuli to monkeys, monkey frontal cortex is much more activated than human cortex. But we want to go a little bit further by this sort of like gives sort of like a rough idea of rough correspondences between monkey and human areas. But we want to go further and sort of like trying to figure out, okay, which specific areas in the humans might correspond with specific areas in the monkey, which is sort of like a little bit more interesting, which comes to the original statement that I made. We want to know areas in the monkey or in the human that corresponds to the monkey to do follow-up experiments. And we want to get that kind of information in an as unbiased manner as possible without making too many assumptions. So you basically can correlate voxels or ROIs within a species. You can do the same thing in the other species, but now without having to blow up the monkey brain into a human space, basically, you can sort of like correlate simple time signals from one ROI or few voxels in one species to the other species. Yeah. So you don't basically blow it up, you don't make any assumptions of how these brains have to be deformed to get into the other space. And of course you can do that from one species to the other and vice versa. Yep. And then when you do that, for example, if you see it in monkey MT, this is the intraspecies correlation in MT. Of course within the species, MT is correlated with areas that are sort of like functionally connected with that area, and you get sort of like relatively discrete areas that are correlated in dorsal stream within the same species. So when you go from monkey to human, you also get human MT. Again, this is data taken from one species and you're looking in the other species. Data taken from monkey MT and you're looking which areas are correlated in the other species. And you get very clear MT, and again, also like here, some of these dorsal areas. So for MT, this works reasonably well. This is actually the same thing, different half of the data. You see it's very comparable if you split your data in half. of course, you can start in human empty. In human empty, you get more or less the same when you use the monkey empty data. You see it in human empty, you get sort of like also the dorsal stream areas. But and you, when you go to the interspecies comparison, you basically only getting empty in the monkey. So again, using completely independent data basically reveals that these areas are functionally very, very similar or doing very similar things. Same thing, other set of data. And basically, I think I can skip this. The same thing holds true for other areas. V1 here, left V1, right V1, left V2, right V2. So you get sort of like, for some areas it doesn't work, you get sort of like nicely corresponding correlations in regions where we think they should be correlated. Yeah. So for MT, basically when you see it in human MT, you get like monkey MT and also, in monkey MT you get sort of like human MT and then the areas that are also correlated. Of course, most often you get not one single area, but a network of areas that are dealing in a similar way with these stimuli. Of course, it's not only MT that deals with the motion aspects in these natural stimuli. There are many more areas that are responding to these motion stimuli. The next step, you can go completely unbiased and have the program decide completely what's going on by using multivariate and model-free clustering ICA analysis. Yeah, you basically correlate everything with everything. You sort of like, you can start with voxels, but probably an easier way is starting with Royce in one species and Royce in other species, which are independently defined. And you just ask, you know, how do they correlate? How do these Royce correlate with each other? Then you get sort of like a correlation matrix, of course. Complicated. You get like a lot of independently defined ICAs in the two species, and you correlate these with each other. And then you apply a very strict threshold on it. You say, of course, you do a lot of comparisons, so you have to correct for many comparisons that you're making, and multiple for multiple comparisons, correcting for multiple comparisons. And also you correct the degrees of freedom because again you do a lot of comparisons to correct for out-correlations in the data. And then you end up actually with a relatively restricted set where the correlations become significant in the matrix. And then you can go back. You can ask which are these clusters basically which show a significant correlation in the two species. Yeah. Or between the two species. So you get something like this, you get sort of like a cross-correlation matrix, then you can again do a clustering, yeah? You can again a clustering, and again the only assumption you're making there is sort of like there needs to be a ROI of every species in this cluster. And then you get sort of like a sorted cross-correlation matrix based upon this spatial clustering algorithm that you're doing, and then you can see, okay, which are these? And then you go back to the brains to try to identify them. It's very, very assumption free. You don't basically make any assumption except here that you want to have an item in one area, a ROI in one species and the other species. That's the only assumption that you're making. Because we're comparing across species, which makes a lot of sense. And then, for example, for one cluster, cluster number one here, I'm just giving one example, it's completely assumption-free. You get monkey empty and you're getting human empty. Yeah? So I think this is sort of like a very clear way to define this in a very unbiased manner. So you don't have any assumption, you're getting actually these two areas out very nicely. It worked for a number of areas, not for all areas. I'm just showing here MP. A second example, if I have time. Do I have time? Yes. A second example where we use this intra-species activity correlation method, so where we correlate activity of time courses, or where we correlate time courses across species, actually is not sort of like broad, like with this net your vision experiment, but more fine-tuned to a very specific functional network, the phase network. And most of you do know about the phase networks, the sort of like phase areas in the brain that are preferentially processing phase stimuli over other non-phase stimuli, identified both in humans and in monkeys. We don't know what the correspondence is actually between these phase areas in the human and in the monkey, and that's why we set out on a number of experiments trying to match up these different phase areas in the two species. So basically, whenever you compare activity between when you're watching two faces versus no face stimuli, a number of people, including Doris Tsao and Winrich Freiwald, and also we basically, find a number of patches, and actually originally in the human this was done by Nancy Kenwisher, and then followed up by many, many other people, of course. A number of face patches, mainly restricted to the ventral stream, a little bit also more dorsally, SDS areas, and so forth. I'm not going into the details there. In a monkey, more or less same picture. By and large, about six face patches in each hemisphere. Yeah. How do they link up? We have very little clue. There is some evidence in the past where people tried to spatially match, using spatial assumptions to try to match up these different areas, but there is very little direct evidence to match, for example, OFA with one of these phase patches defined by Doris Tsao and Winrich Freiwald. Yep. Why is that important? Well, as I said in the beginning, here in the monkey, you can go in with electrodes and sort of like looking what the single neurons are doing whenever you're presenting these kinds of stimuli. Yeah? So you can have like a much better idea of what these areas are actually doing whenever you're presenting sensory stimuli, phase stimuli, compared to what you can get with basic fMRI experiments. I know in some patients now people have gotten access to these phase areas. Very cool data. They also show this kind of selectivity as here, selectivity for phases here. All the red is basically when phases are shown, when you record single cell activity in these things compared to non-phase stimuli. You see that basically this cell was, or these cells were non-responsive to non-phase stimuli. In these human subjects, however, you have only typically very limited time to record. You can't do like very exhaustive kind of experiments, and you need to be lucky, right, to hit just a phase patch. So it does make sense basically to match up these areas in the two species. If you can say phase area 1 and phase area 1 prime in the two species match up, then you can link these kind of properties, which are very difficult if not impossible to collect in human, you can link these properties with the properties in the human, yeah? Which of course makes this huge literature on human imaging, human face patch imaging or face area imaging, much more relevant and easier to interpret. That's exactly the goal of this kind of experiments. Of course, not only recording neural activity, but also perturbing activity, and seeing how it affects perception of these subjects. You can also link that kind of information then with the human corresponding face patches. So we did a number of experiments to do that, and just one example is where we showed sort of like dynamic faces, scrambled faces to humans and also to monkeys. So it activates very well the face areas. And you present them, fMRI experiment. You also do a localizer, a very simple localizer to identify these different face areas in humans and in monkeys. So you get sort of like activity, higher activity for faces relative to non-face areas. You make a ROI, so you select voxels responding to these faces. You do that in the two species. This is monkey, this is human. And then you can start playing the game of like, okay, how do they correspond with each other? And using that ISAC approach. Of course, the stimuli are presented in exactly identical ways, exactly the same paradigm in the two species. Otherwise, you know, correlating these temporal signals doesn't make any sense. Yeah? So you have to present, and that's sort of like the drawback of this approach, you have to present everything at exactly the same moment in the two species. This is blue is sort of like non-face areas as a control, but as you all know, you can identify face areas by doing this kind of localizer. So at the end of the day, you get, well, in this experiment, we scan 3 animals and 15 human subjects. You sort of like do the analysis in the individual subjects, and then you bring it in the common space, sort of like getting voxels of the well-known face areas in the monkey and in the human. Yeah. Do you get that? And then you can do sort of like that ISAC analysis, so correlating everything with everything, unbiased. You get again this cross-correlation matrix, where in the upper left quadrant of this matrix, basically you have like the face areas, and here the non-face areas. And then you basically can do sort of like what I said earlier. You can see it in a face area and see, okay, where do you get like correlated activity with the stimuli that you presented. In this case, these dynamic stimuli. But for example, if you see it in monkey ML, name doesn't matter, it's just one of these face patches in the monkey, you get sort of like reasonably confined correlated activity basically in other monkey face patches. Also bear in mind, the circle here are the ROIs. These ROIs are not exactly right because it comes from different subjects, so it's sort of like in reality they might be a little bit bigger or even smaller in the different subjects. If you go to the other species, surprise, you get correlated activity reasonably well confined to the face areas, independently defined face areas in these other species. Yeah? And not in the non-face areas here in green. So you can do this game for ML, you can do the same game for PL. Again, this is not too interesting. Within a species, across species, then you get sort of like in, again, in the face areas or in the neighborhood of face areas, correlated activity in the other species. ML, again, ML within the species, across species, you get also a little bit outside it. But the thing is that if you're just looking at the face patches, in the monkey and in the human, you can sort of like get an idea of these correlation values and the distribution of these correlation values when you do that game across different subjects of a species. Yeah, so to get sort of like an idea of the how well this ISAC value is basically, the mean ISAC value holds true across that population. So you get a distribution of these ISAC values. You can do that for one area, but of course you can do that for other areas, and then you can sort of like try to statistically distinguish between ISAC values that you obtain from, in this case I think it's MF, it doesn't matter, MF and other face areas in the other species. Yeah, to see which one is actually corresponding most with, in this case, MF. Yeah, to see whether it is significantly different. That gives us then an idea that indeed with these stimuli, and it's restricted to the stimulus set that you're having, that indeed this area corresponds, for example, to this face area in the human. Yeah. That's not the only thing that you have to do. You also have to look at the reliability of your signals. Signals, and actually that's quite often forgotten, signals vary from location to location. Some locations you have good sensitivity, other locations have worse sensitivity, for all kinds of reasons. So you also have to take into account the reliability of your simply. And this can be basically estimated by doing a very simple leaf one out approach within a species. So how well is actually a particular correlation value, how robust is actually that particular correlation value within a given sectional. You take all the subjects, you take one out, and then you do the correlation between one subject and the n minus one leftover subject. So you can do that in the human, and you can do that in the monkey. The big drawback, and this is the last thing that I'm going to talk about, of this interspecies activity correlation method is that you have to have exactly the same paradigm in the two species. Temporally, the stimuli have to present it in an identical manner. Yeah? But in some cases, and definitely whenever you go to tasks, when I ask you to do something, to respond to a stimulus, and you do worse or better and things like that, you determine the pace of the experiment, right? The subjects determine the pace of the experiments. Every subject will be different. You know, stimuli will be presented at different time points, and of course, when you add two different species to do a similar task, this will be very, very different, right? So then you cannot use this ISAC approach, because temporarily, all the events, sensory, decision, motor events, and so forth, will be different, and you cannot use that procedure. And that's why we moved on to beta correlations, where we use the beta coefficients from your general linear model to feed into this comparative in this analysis, in this comparative analysis. Yeah. And I will explain that as the last experiment that I will go through by a cognitive experiment, trying to link up activity in the superior parietal lobule of humans and whatever area in the monkey. We know that superior parietal lobule in the humans is sort of like engaged in a number of visual spatial tasks. There are a lot of groups basically that have shown that for example, when you're shifting attention, this can be covert, it can be overt, that SPL, superior parietal lobule, is being engaged. And the monkey is not known. That's where actually we know a lot from the human, and this is sort of like a little bit contrary to most other data, where human experiments are inspired by previous monkey experiments, but for this particular function, shifting of attention, we don't know which areas in the monkey are basically activated. There are some hints that actually this might also be the case in the parietal, superior parietal lobe of monkeys, but we have no clear-cut evidence. So the question here is whether or not they're homologous and to use again this data-driven approach without making any assumption, using this beta correlation approach. Same thing, so we have human brain, monkey brain, we scan them, and we basically have them doing a very simple task. I will take a little bit of time to guide you through it. Subjects, monkeys and humans, are asked to fixate, and we show two shapes, two pairs of shapes, right? And in every pair, one shape is relevant for the subject, and the other shape is irrelevant. And the subject simply has to track covertly while fixating the relevant shapes. So you can have a change of shapes. You move from one shape pair to the next shape pair, while the relevant one stays on the same side, or the relevant one changes to the other side. Yeah. So you control basically for a visual change. The shape can change with or without a shift in attention. Yeah. So you fixate, you have two shapes. And then one of them is relevant, the square is relevant, it changes to a diamond, the triangle changes to a circle, so the circle and the diamond is relevant. So here you have an attention shift, you have a shape change and an attention shift. Here the relevant shape stays on the same side. Here, the relevant one goes to the other side. Yeah? It was a very simple experiment. You simply have to track the relevant shape in a covert manner. And you simply have to detect dimmings of the relevant shape, and you have to ignore dimmings of the irrelevant shape. And you can train monkeys to do that relatively easy. Yeah. So this is how it goes. Then you fixate here, you have a relative shape. The R is of course not on the screen when you're doing this kind of experiment. So this one dims, ignore it. You don't have to press a button. You simply have to ignore this one. Then you have a change in shape, but now the relevant is there. Yeah, but you fixate here. The relevant goes there, so you change your attention to there. This relevant one dims. You press a button, and you get a reward or you get a feedback signal, and so forth and so forth. Everybody understand it? Relatively simple experiment. So when you do that in the human and in the monkey, you can sort of like contrast state trials, while there is a change in shape, with shift trials, left and right. Yeah. When you do that, this is important. When you do that, you basically get, as expected from previous studies, you get sort of like superior parietal lobule in humans, and also some frontal areas, and more or less the same thing in the monkey. So this is again what I told you in the beginning, simple GLM, spatially comparing the activity patterns. So if you flatten that in the monkey, this is a flat map of the monkey, you get sort of like this superior parietal activations for shifting versus staying trials, and also some frontal and anterior single cortex. In the humans, exactly the same thing, posterior or SPL, superior parietal lobule, and a little bit of frontal area. Not much in the rest of the cortex. So now we want to take it a step further by using this beta correlation approach, interspecies beta correlation approach. And basically how it works is, as I said, temporal structure is not important. You're only using the beta values for the different conditions of the experiment, and you correlate beta values and not the temporal signal, a signal that you're measuring. Yep. So it was a step further down in the analysis stream. So basically what you do is you select the voxels in one species that is activated during shifting of attention relative to staying of attention. Yeah. And then you get sort of like a beta fingerprint for different trial types during the experiment. Of course, the more trial types that you have, the easier this is. Correlation with a few trial types doesn't make a lot of sense. So you need to have like already a substantial number of different trial types. You get there a beta value from your general linear model, and then you correlate that. You basically correlate this, the average beta fingerprint from SPL in the human, with that in the monkey, and then you get sort of like here the correlation pattern. This is not GLM, this is correlation, basically. And again, you get sort of like superior parietal lobule in the monkey, and again also some frontal areas, including dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, and again anterior cingulate cortex. If you compare that with the original GLM data, this is just like slices basically, horizontal slices through the brain. If you compare that with the original GLM data, it fits very well. Yeah, so it's asserting that with this assumption-free approach, you get more or less the same thing than what you're getting when you straight do this GLM in one species and GLM in the other species. But the advantage is that here, the red voxels, this is actually voxels that are correlated with the signal measured in the other species. Yeah. While the yellow is measured with signals from the same species. Okay, I think I talked already way too long. So I think it's just sort of like a gist of what we are doing, trying to compare activity evoked by different sensory types of stimulations, cognitive tests in different different species, with spatial assumptions using straight GLM, without spatial assumptions with the ISAC method, temporal correlation method, or with beta correlations. The next step that we are trying to do, and actually we have a number of experiments which I don't have time to go into detail, where we're looking at representational similarities between species, so that you're not only looking at activity, but the pattern of activity in different ROIs, and trying to match that up between different ROIs in a different species, and also to correlate actually electrophysiologically measured signals in one species. Obviously, monkey is the easiest one to collect that kind of data, and correlate that with fMRI data in the other species. We're also collecting actually in some patients, in human patients, electrophysiological single cell data, and trying to do the same game by looking at fMRI data in monkeys. Right, I think that's it. Of course, this is work done by many people, both from my lab and also from here. You know, the all the three experiments was done in collaboration with Reiner and several people here in Maastricht. And Dante Martini was the one who was the driving force behind the interspecies activity correlation method, while Natalie and definitely Chi Zhu was a driving force between beta correlation approaches. All right, thank you.